Are you sometimes opening up a compositing flow and you feel a little bit lost? Maybe even open your own work from a few days or weeks ago and you don't immediately see what you did at that time? This certainly happened to me a few times, and this is why I want to show you now how I keep organized while building my compositing flow, what principles I follow to keep it logical and keep it well understandable for myself. This lesson is taken out from my compositing course, where I have a full section on workspace and system setup, where I discuss things like important settings and these kind of introductory things. The full compositing course, see more details on my website, but first enjoy this lesson. So generally I'm reading from left to right and from top to bottom, so I try to follow roughly the same direction while building the flow, right? I'm building it from left to right. If I'm working in 2D, then I think background to foreground. So if I have some background element and then emerge, then my foreground comes onto the background. So I'm reading again left to right, and in the merge the foreground element comes from top into the merge. So that's I know you can put it wherever you like, right? But this seems logical to me. Whatever processing masks typically I put in from top, and then if I have more elements, you try to group these elements somehow visually. If you are working on a certain foreground element, then you get a bigger portion for that foreground element, but I still try to keep the direction organized. I try to avoid any lines that are facing backwards or any lines that are crossing, because this is difficult to read. Let's look at a slightly more difficult flow from a recent tutorial. Here I'm working in 3D. Of course, in 3D you don't always have foreground and background, but sometimes just objects in the scene. Still, I'm working a bit left to right and keeping things together. For example, here I have one merge which takes care of all cameras and lights, so they're all together here and they're actually being used by two different renderers, so I have it separate here. I have here two parallel flows, and the reason is just that I have a certain 3D element here in this group which I am using in both flows, so I'm arranging them exactly in parallel so that I can see immediately, okay, something is happening in parallel and both of these flows are relevant and will then come back together, and there are common elements like this light and camera element which is being used by both flows. Still, I have my main element at the bottom, which is my main background kind of, and then something which comes in from the top and which is being rendered here in parallel. Then there's a little bit of post-processing done. Here it gets a bit chaotic because there are some masks which are again shared by multiple elements from parallel flows. But whatever is happening, it's splitting up and it's coming again together. It's not going backwards or, you know, in circles or anything. So the direction should still be quite clear. And then at the end, whatever is coming out of the render node, so I have two renderers which are exactly in parallel, and then each of them is being processed in different ways, and once they are merged together again, they are coming over a new background, and I'm again in this kind of linear way. Now, there are ways to rename tools, right? You can just F2, you can rename tools. Some people do it all the time and very extensively. I do it very rarely. I might rename groups, I might rename masks if I have a lot together and need to keep an overview. Otherwise, I'm not doing it much. Also, some people use color a lot. You can put these underlays, underlay it's called. It's a tool which you can put underneath and then colorize a section. If you really have a large section where you are working on one specific aspect and then another large section where you work on a completely different aspect, it can help to colorize it. But then again, if these sections are spatially separated and you work first on one section, then you have somewhere you merge, then you have the other section and you have it separated this way, it should also be quite clear. With coloring and commenting, I see it a bit similar to programming. Actually, what this is programming, right? We are creating a program which tells Resolve or Fusion what to do. For people who are coding, there are two different philosophies. Some people tell you you need to comment and annotate everything, right? Whenever you code something, you make some function, some variable, make a note on top why you are doing this. Make a note what this variable is for, make a comment. And the opposite philosophy is some people tell you whenever you're commenting something, you should have made a better code first, because if your code is very logical and very intelligent, then other people can read it even without the comment. So when you're doing a comment, think about maybe you should have written better code first. And I think here with Fusion, it's kind of similar. I see it similar. So if I'm renaming tools and putting colors and so on, think about for a minute, are you doing this because it's required and there's no other way to make it understandable and it's really helpful? Or are you just renaming because somehow things got messy and you needed for that reason? So I think I rename things if it's necessary for clarity, because I don't know, there's just a group and it just says group. Well, okay, rename it and call it logo. Okay, that makes sense. But I don't need to rename a merge because something is coming from left, something is coming from the top. Okay, what is happening there? I can see it, right? Okay, but there are different philosophies. This is mine, and this is how you can see me doing it in the course. Thank you for watching this lesson from my compositing training course. This course builds strong foundations in the art and craft of compositing with Fusion. It covers topics from rotoscoping, keying, integration, 3D camera tracking, all the way up to topics like projection and multipass compositing. And it goes into a level of depth that very few online courses reach. If you're interested, check out the course page for further details, have a look what other students are saying about this course, and I'd be very happy to welcome you inside.